In this video, I'm going to try and review a ton of things about polar coordinates in a very short amount of time. So I'm not going to do a lot of calculating, and I may not actually finish problems. You may have to go back and watch other things or ask questions. I just want to give you a basic review. First of all, finding areas. Remember, please, that the area of a polar is 1/2 the integral of r squared d theta. Okay, that's what we got to keep in mind all the time. Now, we're dependent after that on, you know, what area we're looking for. If we're looking for something like this area that's, you know, shared between the two curves, if we're looking for maybe, you know, this area over here, if we're looking for, I don't know, maybe like this area here, you know, it's very dependent on the problem. Okay. First thing that's going to be true on all of them, though, and that I would recommend always, is to draw a line that connects the origin and the intersection points. And the reason I do that is it just helps us to see which part of the curve we're talking about. Okay. So maybe let's start with that blue area. Okay. So this blue area right here, you'll notice, is the circle. And if we just found the area of the circle, we would get this whole thing. So then we have to subtract out this piece in here. So knowing, you know, I can set these two equations equal to each other. I'm going to rely on the fact that you can do that. These intersection points are pi over 3 and negative pi over 3, or 5 pi over 3. Okay, those are the intersection points. So to find that red area, let's start with that, or that blue area, excuse me, the blue area, we would do 1/2 the integral of the circle squared d theta from negative pi over 3 to pi over 3. If you're worried about the negatives, just do 0 to pi over 3 and double your answer. And we would subtract off the Lyapunov's area from negative pi over 3 to pi over 3. And again, just remember it's 1/2 the integral of r squared. Okay? So that would do that area. And again, just verify in your mind, the first integral got this whole part of the circle, and then we subtracted off this little inner part, and this gave us the blue area. Next, let's do the red. Okay, now you'll notice the red area right here, if I did the circle from like pi over 3 to 5 pi over 3, I would get this whole part that I'm tracing right here. Okay? So let's do that. Let's do 1/2 the integral of the circle from negative pi over 3 to pi over 3. Okay? But then I'm going to have to add in this part right here, because it's, you know, I'm supposed to be finding this whole area. So this is the Lyapunov from negative pi over 3 to pi over 3. Okay, so it's a little different in that you're not always even subtracting in polars. Remember, the bounds must go, oh, excuse me here, this should be pi over 5 pi over 3, and of course, this right here should be positive. The bounds always go from smallest to largest. Okay, so this is pi over 3 of 3 minus 2 sine cosine theta d theta. Okay, now finally, that green area. What we could do with the green area is we could do the entire Lyapunov, which is from pi over 3 to 5 pi over 3, and then we could subtract out the circle. Okay, so let me really quickly do that. We've got 1/2 the integral from pi over 3 to 5 pi over 3 of 3 minus 2 cosine theta squared d theta minus 1/2 the integral of 2 squared d theta from pi over 3 to 5 pi over 3. So there are lots of areas we can find. Remember, 1 half the integral of r squared. And again, I would recommend every single time, put these lines in there and be very careful. Remember, you're not always subtracting. Sometimes you're adding. Sometimes the bounds are different. So just be very careful. Let's move on. One question that came up recently on the AP exam had to do with distance between the curves. And this is fairly easy to find because, remember, everything references from the origin. So if I said, what's the distance between the two curves, like at this angle, all I would need to do, really, is calculate this value. And that value could be found by doing the big value of r minus the small value of r. And that would give me total distance. Okay, and of course, in that case, the picture that I drew, the big R, would be given by 3 minus 2 cosine theta, and the small r would be given by this. So, again, it could be different. You know, in this area over here, the larger r is the circle and the smaller r is the limekin, but it depends what quadrant you're in. Now, the next question that was asked is, how is that distance changing? Well, this is easy enough to do because that just means you do, how is the big R changing? So big R derivative minus small R derivative equals how the distance is changing. So a very easy calculation to figure out how far apart the curves are and how that distance is changing. All right, let's move on. So let's say we're down to one curve and we're asked to find like the slope of something, okay? So dy dx. Please remember, the big thing to remember in almost every case, other than area and maybe distance, is this key that x is equal to r cosine theta and y is equal to r sine theta. And I would write that on my paper right away. So in our case, okay, let's kind of come up here, x is r cosine theta. And y is r sine theta. So as I find the derivative, I would need to do a massive product rule. So y, we have first, got my 2 there, times derivative of the second plus second times derivative of the first. And on the bottom, we do dx first times derivative of the second plus second times derivative of the first. And then if we were asked to do this at a point, we would just plug it in. Now, other things we might be asked to do, well, first of all, dy dx, of course, has always told us the slope. But other things we might be able to ask to do is, you know, find dy d theta. Well, dy d theta, of course, if I could just draw an arrow, this is just the numerator. It's how y was changing. And this tells us how the curve is moving up or down. It's what y always tells us. So if we just found dy d theta at a point, we'd say, well, is the curve moving up or down at that point? Of course, we could also be asked to do dx d theta. And again, I'm going to draw an arrow because dx d theta is just the denominator. And this tells us how something is moving from side to side. And finally, kind of the last big thing you might be asked to do is dr d theta. Well, dr d theta is just saying what's the derivative of r. Well, that actually, you know, if this right up here is your r, the derivative of that was 2 sine theta. Now, what does that tell us? Well, that tells us in relation to the origin, how are we moving? So if you think about the graph, are we moving towards the origin or are we moving away from the origin? Okay. All right, moving on. Sometimes the problems are suddenly turned into parametric problems. Something like this. It says make every theta equal to t. Okay. So now it becomes 3 minus 2 cosine t. So remember that x is equal to r cosine, and y is equal to r sine. And what you've got here now is a parametric problem. Okay? And I'm not going to belabor this a whole lot, but you, at this point, you've got, you know, a position vector that could easily through, you know, a derivative, which of course we already did, could be turned into a velocity vector, and then we could do a second derivative and get an acceleration vector, but we have just turned this into a, that's supposed to say position vector with our x and our y. Okay, so just be aware they could pull that out. Finally, what if they made it a related rate? This has happened before, where suddenly they say the angle is changing with the rate of something. How is x changing? Well, what you've got to remember, of course, is that in our case, in this problem, x is equal to r cosine theta. So if we're doing the derivative with respect to t, that means we're saying, okay, 3 minus, I'm going to do my product rule first. Derivative of cosine theta is sine negative sine theta dt. Okay, we've got to use this little chain rule, this implicit piece, because of the related rate. Plus the second times derivative of the first, and the derivative of the first would be positive 2 sine theta dt. And of course, we have a d theta dt to substitute in, and we'd be given an angle, and then we could do that as well. So lots of things here. We've got areas. We've got slope. We've got y changing, x changing, r changing. We could make this a parametric question fairly easily, and we could always turn it into a related rate. So lots of things to review in polars.